Okay, the Gauss law is giving the information about how much the flux is going to be generating based on the charge movement. That relationship is given and studied by a Gauss, by the name person Gauss, and for that reason the law is given the name as a Gauss law. What is this in giving the information for us? Gauss law states that the total electric flux, that is psi, through any closed surface, the electric flux through any closed surface is equal to the total charge enclosed by that surface. Means the flux what's going to be producing due to those point charges. How many charges are there of that surface, that much the flux is going to be generating. That's the information about the Gauss law. Here, let the distribution of charge, here the distribution of charge is shown like here, like this, shown as a cloud of point charges. A cloud of point charges are there, surrounded by a closed surface of any shape. Here itself surrounded by a some of the shapes. Here just I draw a take around small closed surface like this. You can write any way you want, it is no restrictions. You should draw a diagram like this, but it should be any closed surface. The closed surface may be surface of the same real material. What is going to be taken here? Some of the material, real material we are going to be using of. Here, it's a more generally, it is any closed surface with surface which wish to visualize. We can see which surface you are going to be taking, that you should see. That's the information here going to be. The figure is telling the information about the electric flux density, that is ds, for the due to the surface charge, for that reason s, at point due to charge q. At point here is the p and here is the q charge. Then total flux passing through the surface area, that is surface, this surface delta s, this charge is going to be moving, passing through this, and it's moving with a further direction, that's it. Through delta S is going to be taken as ds dot with differential surface, that is delta S. Here, next, if the total charge is Q, the total charge what's going to be, it is Q, then Q coulombs of electric flux, will pass through the enclosing surface. Means based on the q, how many q's are there, means our q charges are there, that much the flux is going to be generating and passing through the surface of this surface, that is here is taken as a small surface, that is delta s, pass through the enclosing surface. At every point on the surface of this surface, of this part, the electric flux density, that is vector d, will have the same value as, that is ds. From the Stokes theorem, for the one point charge what is going to be affecting, for the whole surface it will be the same. Based on that information, here we are telling, that is the flux density of vector v will have the same values for ds also. Then ds will be general vary with the magnitude and the direction. From one point to the another point, it depends. One point to the another point, our flux is going to be changing. Then, considering a nature of an incremental element of the surface, means a small change. Our surface, if we, instead of taking off only of this part, if I take again one bigger part of this, what it's going to be? Surface, an incremental element area here, it's taken as delta S. This delta S is an somewhat incremented area. Delta S is very nearly a portion of the plane surface. A small change. But the change is going to be, that is taken as a delta. And the complete description of this surface element requires not only the statement of its magnitude. Observe here, the change what is going to be taken means extra area if you are going to take, it should have the magnitude, that is delta S, but also its orientation, means which surface area you are going for, in which direction it is moving. Those all matters here. Means if I am going to take a small extra part of this, then how is our charge movement across this surface and which direction it is moving further. Means if it is of which direction the movement is of that material, in which way it is going to be, whether it is in a rotating fashion or it is in a horizontal movement, in which direction it is going to be moving. Based on that, it is not only the statement of magnitude but also its orientation in the space, whether it is rotating or it is going to be shifting towards and forwards, in which direction it is moving. That's what the information it is telling for us, not only the magnitude but also it depends on the orientation. In other words, the incremental surface element is of a vector quantity, means delta S is having both the magnitude and also the direction or else the orientation. You can write any of the word here. Then the only unique direction which may be associated with delta S is the direction of the normal to the plane, which is tangent to the surface at the point in the, what is it going to be. Means for the surface, if I have to go with a tangent line, based on the tangent line, there you can get the in which direction it is moving for. That's what here it is taken as which angle. This is its rotation. Next, at any point P, consider an incremental element of surface delta S. At any point P in the whole surface, you can assume anywhere, but here just take a for example here, and let ds make an angle theta with delta S as shown in the figure. Theta make an angle with the surface and to the flux density, that is ds. Then the flux crossing to the delta S, the incremental surface area, is then the product of the normal component of ds and delta S. Therefore, the incremental flux is going to be due to the incremental surface, the flux crossing through that surface area, means how much the flux is going to be moving through this area, that's what ds normal with the incremental, then that is going to be equals to ds cos theta of delta S incremental surface. Then directly you can write this equation, or else if you write this equation is also well and good. That is flux density ds with the surface area dot delta S, that is incremental surface area. Then the total flux passing through the closed surface is obtained by, it's going to be obtained by adding the differential contributions crossing each surface element, that is delta S. That is the equation is going to be psi is equals to increment d psi, or else increment integration with a closed surface for the reason a circle, then this ds dot, this is flux density dot ds, the with respect to the surface for that reason. Then the resultant integral is a closed surface integral, and since the surface element ds bar is always involves the differential of two coordinates, here the ds, what's going to be, it depends on which, in which direction the our flux density is going to be varying, either it may be in terms of dx dy or else yz dx dz or dz with dx, anything dy dz also, but two variables should vary and one should be a constant. That we part we already taken in the previously. Based on that, we will be writing the equation here. Then, comma, in terms of your, this is in terms of Cartesian, in cylindrical form, rho into d pi into d rho. In terms of a spherical, r square sine theta d theta d pi. The integral is double integral. If we are going to take in terms of dx dy, d pi d rho and d theta and d pi, when we are taking this, you have to make in two integrals instead of one. Then a small circle in the equation, if this is a small circle on the integral sign itself to indicate that the integration is to be performed over a closed surface. The surface which we are going to take is of a, should be a closed one. Then observe here, this is very important. Such a surface is often we are calling as Gaussian surface. Which surface area you are going to be testing? What is the flux of that area when a charge is going to be passing through that area? To find this, what's the area you are going to be assuming? Which area you are going to be assuming? That area is going to be taken as Gaussian surface. Area or else the surface is taken as a Gaussian surface. Then for Gaussian's or Gauss-Kla equation is going to be psi is going to be equals to integration with the closed. This is Gaussian surface with the S surface ds dot ds bar ds with a both in terms of vectors that is going to be equals to the charge enclosed, that is the thing that our Q. This is what our Gauss-Kla is telling for us. What's the definition of Gauss-Kla is satisfying with the equation here. Then the charge enclosed might be a several point charges, means it's not only one point charge will be moving and coming back, but here it there will be many point charges. For that reason, here it is the equation is going to be taken as Q is equals to summation with the Qn. How many are there? Based on that, you have to take that. Then, for line charge, Q is going to, we already taken the equation. Again, here it is going to be written one more time. For line charge, Q is going to be rho integration, rho L dl. For surface, rho S ds. For volume charge, rho V dv. Then, Gauss-Kla in terms of charge distribution, closed integral with surface, that is Gaussian surface. Ds dot ds is going to be equals to, this is flux density, it is a differential surface area, okay, that is going to be with the volume rho v dv. If I am going to take in the in terms of a surface charge, here the equation is going to be taken as rho s ds. In terms of line charge, it is going to be rho l dl. Like that, the equation will be going on varying. This is about a Gauss-Kla. This is very important. This will be asking in the exam, repeatedly asked question in the exam for, depends on question paper, but maximumly it will ask for 6 marks. Okay. This is about the Gauss-Kla. Next, some of the applications of a Gauss-Kla. This is also important. They may give, ask, I explain the Gauss-Kla. Some of the applications may be point charge like this, they may ask for. The procedure for applying Gauss-Kla to calculate what we have to going to be calculating the electric field involves the first knowing whether it is of a symmetric axis exists or not. That is first important information. Once it has been found that symmetric charge distribution exists, then we construct a mathematical closed surface. Means first we will check whether electric field involves asymmetric exist, means whether I can calculate for the further process or not. For the point charge, how the characteristics it will be varying on that surface. I will check first the symmetric, means first I will check for this and then check for this. If the both properties of both, if it is giving the same result, then I will, it will be easy to find out the whole surface with some part. If I take that, then it will be easy to find out. That's what he are telling. Mathematical closed surface, then that is known as Gaussian surface. The surface is chosen such that, observe here, D, flux density, is normal or else a tangent to the Gaussian surface. A Gaussian surface, its Gaussian surface is just assuming one surface on the material. This surface area, just assuming, then if for this surface area, we will be calculating how much the flux is going to be varying due to the point charge. Okay. Then when D is normal to the surface, then D dot ds is going to be equals to D dot ds, because D is a perpendicular to the surface. Here, if I go with the figure, observe here. This is perpendicular. The line what is going to be, this is perpendicular to each other, D, and the surface what where it is going to be, this is normal, DS, normal. Okay, the same way here we are telling. When D is tangential to surface, then D dot DS is going to be equals to zero. Then we must choose the surface that has some of the symmetry exhibit by charge distribution. Then the choice of appropriate Gaussian surface where there is a symmetric in the charge distribution comes from intuitive region and a slight degree of maturity in the applications of the Coulomb's law. Means if we are able to find out the Gaussian surface, then it will be easy to find apply the Coulomb's law. Just you remember this somewhat it will be tricky to observe how it is going to be varying, how the charge is moving, how it is going to be taking. Just you remember, if we able to find the Gaussian surface correctly, assuming correctly, then it will be easy to apply our Coulomb's law. That will be easy for you. Then we'll go move with the first one for applications of Gauss law is going for the point charge. Suppose a point charge Q is located at the origin. To determine the flux density D at point P, it is easy to see that the choosing of a spherical surface containing P will satisfy the symmetric condition. Here it is given. For point P, in the previous cases, how we taken the when point location is going to be taken means just taken and we taken here point and drawn the line, and here is the point P. Then we started the calculating of the Coulomb's law. We derived the equation and all. But here what we are going to be, we are making a small Gaussian surface of that point where it is there for the radial in three dimensional way, in which where it is varying x, y, z direction also. That's what containing a spherical surface we are going to be for the point P, where it is giving the symmetric condition is going to be satisfying. Okay, spherical for up the to the point. Next, thus the spherical surface centered at the origin is the Gaussian surface. What is in the shown in the figure? This is a spherical what we drawn, it is of a Gaussian surface. Then a D is everywhere normal to the Gaussian surface. From the previously we already came to know the D, what is going to be, you should draw with a normal or else a tangential. Okay, we can go with any of the method. Normal to the Gaussian surface, that D is going to be equals to dr and ar, because the Gaussian surface what we assume it is of a spherical. Remember that for the spherical what is the varying factors? dr and d theta. This is, here it is our r radius, a dr and ar. Applying the Gauss law, that is psi is going to be equals to the point charges enclosed, that is what Q is going to be. Therefore Q is going to be equals to integration with the Gaussian surface S d dot ds equals to dr with the integration ds, closed integration, okay, that is going to be equals to dr 4 pi r square. This surface area here, it is going to be 4 pi r square. Where, observe here the equation is written, how we got this integration of ds. Observe, integration, closed integration ds, that is going to be where it is varying. We told that it's of a spherical, for that reason pi is varying from 0 to pi, then theta is varying from 0 to pi, r square sin theta d pi. If you integrate this, you'll be getting 4 pi r square is the surface area of the Gaussian surface. Therefore d is going to be, flux density is going to be, based on this equation only, d is equals to q divided by 4 pi r square into ar. You have to remember this equation for point charge. In any of the problem, if it is asked, you should remember that our flux density is going to be equals to q divided by 4 pi r square into ar. This is for the point charge. When I go for infinite line charge, then what is the line charge equation for the q? Rho l, right? Suppose the infinite line of uniform charge rho l coulombs per meter lies along a z axis. Observe here, lies along a z axis. This is what the line charge, it is existing. To determine the flux density d at point p, we choose a cylindrical surface. For this we are going to be taking a cylindrical surface. Whichever the surface areas we already learnt in the previously, the same thing we have to, Cartesian, cylindrical, spherical. We have still more, but for our syllabus we have only of these three. Based on these three only, which surface area if I enclosed for my line charge, that will be giving the result for us. We are studying of that part only. We choose a cylindrical surface containing a P to satisfy the symmetry condition. Here it is shown in figure. Here the flux density is varying, observe here, in this direction. Then the flux density is constant and normal to the cylindrical surface. Normal means it's going to be like this. Then for d is going to be d rho into a rho. Cylindrical, it's in terms of a rho for that reason. Then Gauss law, to an arbitrary length l, it's going to be rho l into l, that is equals to q, that is equals to integration with surface area dE dot ds, that is equals to d rho integration of s ds, that is going to be equals to 2 pi rho l, where integration ds 2 pi rho l is the surface area of the Gaussian surface. Then ds d dot, integration of d dot ds is evaluated on top and bottom surfaces, top and bottom surfaces of the cylinder is zero. Observe here, top and bottom is going to be zero. Since d has no z component, it's not varying with respect to z, for that reason, that means t is flux density is tangential to those surfaces. Our flux density, it's going to be tangential towards our x and y direction. That's what the information here it is telling. Then our D is going to be equals to rho L divided by 2 pi rho into A rho based on the equation. You should remember the equation of the last equation what you will be getting along with the figures. Then for infinite sheet of charge, considering the infinite sheet of uniform charges, that is rho s coulombs per meter square, lying on the z is equals to zero plane, means it is exist in between of x and y. Here the figure is shown, here point charge, and this is what extra we drawn, it is of a Gaussian surface, and flux density is passing through like this, and this is the infinite sheet of charge rho s coulombs per meter square. Here it is placed. To determine the D at point P, we choose a rectangular box. Observe here what is taken. This is rectangular box that is cut symmetrically by sheet of the charge and has two of its faces parallel to sheet. This parallel to sheet faces, observe, by observing only we will be able to get this. Then D is a normal to the sheet, that is D is going to be dz into az. Applying Gauss law, the rho s integration of s ds, that's going to be equals to q, that is equals to closed surface integral, then d dot ds is, that is going to be equals to, here we have to consider for the top and bottom of this. For that reason, integration dz taken as outside, dz top ds plus integration bottom of ds, then d dot ds evaluated on both sides of the box is going to be 0, because d has no components along x and y direction. It's not having any component in which in these directions for that reason. Then on each top and bottom faces of a box, area is going to be A only. Observe here, here is A only, this area. For that reason, rho s into A is got is going to be dz A plus A. Therefore, D is going to be equals to rho s divided by 2 az. If I add an A, it cancels. Therefore, we are getting out rho s divided by 2 az. Or else, in terms of E is equals to field intensity, E is going to be equals to D divided by epsilon naught. That is going to be rho s divided by 2 times epsilon naught into az. You will be getting. This is about infinite sheet, then infinite line, and also about the point charge. Next, last one is of uniformly charged in terms of a sphere. Then consider a sphere of radius A with a uniform charge rho naught coulombs per meter cube. To determine D, everywhere we construct a Gaussian surface such that R should be less than or equals to A and R should be greater than or equals to A in a different fashions. Observe here. The first case, it is R is less than A. In the second case, R is greater than A. These are two Gaussian surface we'll be assuming. Then for R less than or equals to A, the total charge enclosed by a spherical the radius R is going to be Q and enclosed is going to be rho v dv. Then here rho naught integration of dv. Here it is going to be pi is varying from 0 to pi, 2 pi theta from 0 to pi and R from 0 to R. R square sine theta dr d theta d pi. If you solve for this, you will be getting as rho naught 4 by 3 pi r cube. then therefore the flux is going to be integration, closed integration d dot ds, again dr integration closed to surface ds, that is going to be here again because of a spherical r square sin theta d theta d pi, where pi is varying from 0 to 2 pi, theta varying from 0 to pi. Then repeating as previously, the same thing, dr 4 pi r square. Therefore, psi is going to be equals to q due to the Gauss law. Then I can write here as dr 4 pi r square, that is going to be equals to 4 pi r cube divided by 3 into rho naught. That or else I can write here as d is going to be equals to r by 3 rho naught ar, where r is in between 0 to a. This is for the first condition of this condition. Based on the applications in which you are going to be finding of the flux density, how much it's going to be, the Gaussian surface, in which way you are going to choose, based on that the equation is going to be. For the equation what we got, it is for where r is less than a. When it is r is greater than a, then q enclosed is going to be equals to integration with rho v dv, that is going to be equals to rho naught integration v dv, that is equals to the same thing what we taken in the previously, here also the same rho naught 4 by 3 pi a cube we will get. Then our flux density psi is going to be integration with the closed integration surface d dot ds, that is going to be equals to same thing what we taken here 4 pi r square, again here it is going to be changing, equate both the equation, then d you will be getting as a cube divided by 3 r square rho naught ar, where r is greater than or equals to a. Therefore, finally, we can write the equation in a simplified manner, that is d is equals to r by 3 rho naught a r, when r is in between of 0 to a. When r is greater than a, equal to a, then you will be getting as a cube divided by 3 r square rho naught a r. You should remember the last equations are very important. Okay, this is a sketch of the mod of magnitude of D against R for the uniformly charged sphere. This is how it will be looking like. Starting it will be increasing, then it's going on reducing. This is what the relationship between R and your magnitude of the D flux density. Then from the equations, the d out of the integral sign is the key to find the d using of the Gauss law. This is what the information is telling. In other words, d must be a constant on the Gaussian surface. The lastly, it's giving the information that d should be a constant in the Gaussian surface. That's what the information we got from the Gaussian surface. These are all the applications of Gauss law and about the Gauss law. Gauss law is very important. The equations of each point charge, in terms of point charge, line charge, then about a infinite sheet, then about a sphere. Last equations are very important. And you remember how we got the equation of this, how to find the q and also how to find the psi. Then equate of those, it is about the Gauss law. And what you will be getting the last equation. These equations play a very important role when we go with the solving the problems. Okay, we'll stop here. We'll continue in the next class. Gauss law is very important. Answer your attendance.